Just before we get started, I want to point out that the people sitting on this stage spent a combined total of over 50 years bringing this wonderful book to the big screen. Jeff, from what I understand, you alone have spent 20 years on this project.
That's a little exaggerated. Maybe about 18, something like that. Yeah.
Hyperbole.
But I originally wanted to direct my father, Lloyd Bridges, in the film, and I wanted to make a movie with him that my kids could see. They were all young kids at the time, and I was looking at a catalog of children's books and came across this wonderful cover of this grizzled old guy with a Newbery Award stamp on there. And I thought, oh, this is great, you know. And I read it, and I was knocked out on a kid book level, but also as an adult. And I thought, oh, this is a movie I'd love to see being made. Turns out that Lois took that photograph of the guy on the cover. Yeah.
No kidding. On the cover of The Giver, you took. Who was the guy?
Is this on?
He was a Swedish painter named Carl Gustav Nelson. At the time, I was a photojournalist. And I'd been hired to do an article about him and to photograph him. And he was dead by the time I wrote the book, but I had saved the photograph.
Amazing. So you were a photojournalist, and now you're a millionaire novel writer. So
novel writer. Yes.
Aspirational. So how does it feel to actually have been working on this project long enough to play The Giver?
Yeah, I finally qualified as the grizzled guy on the cover, you know. It was funny. It felt just, you know, wonderful. So much of the success of a film creatively, and I believe, you know, its success in the theaters, people seeing it, depends on the casting, you know, not only the casting of the actors, but who's going to, you know, be the director, who's going to be our cinematographer, and all of those slots were just filled in such a beautiful way that... The movie kind of transcended my high expectations, really, for it.
I am curious, Bob, I know you were the first writer on this, also 18 years ago, and I want to ask the writers, Bob and Michael, why do you think this story was so hard to bring to the screen?
Well, I'm older, so I'll go first. I wasn't older when this started, but I am now. Well, you know, the book is very sort of internal. A lot of it is Jonas's experience and what... And there's Brent. You know, I'm meeting a lot of these people for the first time today.
Yeah, hi.
Hi. How are you? Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
They were all very difficult to work with, I have to say. But it's a very internal sort of story. And, you know, frankly, the book, you know, there's... I'm trying to do this without giving away plot for those who haven't seen it, but there is a point where Jonas decides to leave this community. And once he does... The story, the book, actually just stays with him. We never go back to see how his departure affects the community. We know it's going to affect them, but we don't see it in the book. That was Lois's choice when she wrote it. But for the movie, when I did my drafts way back, I thought, well, we have to see what's going on back in the community. So it was really a creation of a whole new storyline and expanding some of the parts. And the chief elder, who was basically virtually a cameo in the book, her role is expanded, which is great, because when you have Meryl Streep, you want to give her a little something to do. So it was taking the book as a basis, but sort of branching out from there and finding ways to make it visual and you know, put some action in it.
And still retain the spirit of it, which is what they were able to do, I think.
Michael?
I think a lot of it was also timing and the people you see in front of you. The fact that Jeff was so enthusiastic about the project for so many years and didn't let it go. And then, you know, Nikki Silver, who has been through a struggle similar to Jonas in order to get this movie made. And of course, Mr. Noyce, being the right director and finding the right cast. I think a lot of it was timing and luck, and especially the talents of everyone else here.
And I feel like I should call him Mr. Noyce now. Phillip, what attracted you to this? Was it the script or the book that you read first?
It was the book, yeah. And it was the ideas of the book. I mean, I think we all, well, I know I do. I embrace technology, but I also fear it. In some ways, I think that we're losing contact with each other. So the portrait of a future society where technology ruled completely seemed like it was something like looking in the mirror every morning and not actually speaking to my friends, but just sending them one word, texts. You know, so it felt to me like it was a cautionary tale about the future, but about the present as well.
I understand that embracing but fearing, because part of me kind of wanted to live in that village. Like, it was really nice that you created.
Well, it'd be good to have no pain, wouldn't it, in a sense. And, you know, every day I wake up at the moment, I keep thinking about Meryl Streep and that scene towards the end of the movie where she's arguing with Jeff's character and says every time human beings have a choice, they make the wrong choice. There's something right about that. And yet, would we ever want to give up freedom of choice? No, we wouldn't. So all of these questions are questions that ran through my mind when I first read the book, and that's what made me want to make it into a movie, because I think they're fundamental questions about, you know, what makes us human. That's what Lois has forced us to consider.
And Nikki, for you, I mean, you've been with this project, I think, also 18 years.
Very long time.
Since you were 10, apparently.
I appreciate that. Since the birth of my first son, I will tell you, who's here today. So.
What is it like to finally see it on the big screen? And, I mean, in a way, are you glad you waited? Because you wouldn't have had this cast otherwise.
Well, am I glad I waited? I am thrilled about the film we have now. And, you know, you can't make something happen before it's time. And evidently, this was the time of The Giver. And I think what Jeff was saying, too, it's every side of this film that we're proud of. From this incredible cast that we put together, to the cinematographer, to Phillip, our captain, who just did such an unbelievable job, and to have the support of Lois, who has really been with us the entire way and helped us with the silliest of texts that Phillip would send probably at midnight and then again at 6 a.m. the next morning. It's been a journey, but certainly one that's well worth it. And now we're really excited to give it to all of you.
And can I ask the actors, what attracted you to your roles? And was it intimidating at all working with legends like Jeff Bridges and Meryl Streep and Phillip Noyce, for that matter?
Totally. It was your question's a little more intimidating, to be honest. But Jeff was great to work with. I had a dream of a time. And, you know, when you get this gift, this opportunity, you kind of have to pinch yourself every morning before you go to work. And it was like that every day, so it was great. And to work with a fellow Aussie was pretty cool, too.
We had our own special language.
They did. Nobody understood a word they were saying.
G'day, mate. Are they saying hello?
Basically one word.
Are they
mate.
Saying hello? They're saying something profound that we should know.
If I was bad in a scene, he'd say, mate. If I was good, he'd say, mate. But only I understood what he was saying.
Katie, for you?
I was very excited to be a part of this film. The book is so beloved, and to work with, to be a part of this project with Jeff and Meryl Streep and all of these amazing actors was a pure delight, and to work with Phillip was wonderful. And I think that, you know, it was interesting to play this character, because this world is, you know, there's no emotion, there's no, you know, pain. And so for an actor, you know, you're always trying to emote, but you can't. So it was interesting. And to play someone who, you know, playing Brenton's mom and having him have these experiences that were so foreign to my character, and also being the guardian of the rules of this world was really interesting and quite a challenge. But mostly it was just an honor to be a part of, to be of something of such what I think is a very valuable piece of work.
No, what everyone else has said, I think it's such an honor to work with these greats. And really, when you meet them, they're very relaxed and warm and make you feel really comfortable, because it can be really intimidating. And we had this kind of warm environment on set, too. And working with Phil, you know, my character takes such a journey, too, because I'm not completely like the Giver and Jonas. I'm not fully feeling things and I'm not getting memories. But still, I start off really naive and happy and thinking that I'm in a good place. And then once I stop taking my injections, it's just kind of a like a state of confusion. And I don't really understand what I'm feeling. And he's trying to explain it to me. And then towards the end, it kind of goes to anger because I realize the cruelty behind this community. So I think that arc was really interesting. And it's such a great story. So I'm really fortunate.
Cameron?
Oh, well, I mean, when I got the audition for this movie, they said that this is a, you know, a book that's acclaimed and taught in all these schools, produced by the Weinstein Company with this great director and these fantastic actors, Jeff Bridges, Meryl Streep. And I was like, what have they ever done? Oh, boring. I mean, I guess if I have to go to this audition. So kicking and screaming, I was dragged over to go act in a Meryl Streep movie, I guess. No, it was, you know, obviously having the chance to work with Jeff, with Katie, and to be able to tell this really amazing story. I read the book when I was auditioning, and it's just a really beautiful story about humanity and what it means to be human and love and all these great things. And, you know, it's just something I wanted to be a part of.
I think that, one of the draws of doing this project was this book, and the reason why I think, you know, it's so beloved by so many and why schools, you know, have it on their reading list is because of these powerful themes and having children really decide for themselves what they think is important and that free choice. So I'm very happy to be a part of the film adaptation of this.
I also feel like the film has a very distinctive look. That is, I don't know if Phillip can speak to that, but I love the look of this movie.
Well, the look of the movie is inspired by Lois's words, the way she describes the absolutely restricted palette and perception that Jonas starts with, and the way in which he gradually starts to perceive color and emotion. The visual style evolves as his experience becomes more complex, but it's as if it was composed from a primer written by Lois.
That's great. We have a question right here.
For Katie, what was it like for you to play this tough mother so into maintaining the law that it was kind of at the expense of your own child? You're kind of like the fun killer of the family a little bit. Like, no, you can't take the baby home. You can't have emotions.
I really enjoyed playing this character. I think that for me, what I loved about this character is, she is trying so hard to maintain this order. This is what she knows, and this. You know, Jonas is going through something she doesn't know, and it's very threatening, and it fills her with a great deal of conflict. And so I think, you know, it's always interesting to play people that have a lot going on.
We have some in the front row here.
Congratulations to all of you. This is truly, it's a powerful, thought-provoking film. And I truly hope that schools actually embrace this for the classrooms. This question goes out primarily, I think, to Jeff and Nikki can respond best. An obscure little thing I noticed in the film is you bookend the film with Silent Night, and it happens to be the version by the Von Trapp children. Was this done intentionally in terms of the subtextual metaphor for what the Von Trapps actually endured in the real world?
You take this one, Nick. You take this one.
I was like, really, Jeff, it's all yours. Cool. No, really.
That's cool.
Phillip?
Yeah. And it kind of goes with Cameron's character a little bit, too.
I will say that the specific version of Silent Night was not intentional, but that the importance of Silent Night being in the film was important to all of us, in that I think it's a very universal, when you think of family, you think of universal moments. The playing of Silent Night sort of represented that, you know, Jonas reaches this house and there is something happening inside. And how do you very quickly tell an audience there's, you know, love and family and togetherness? And that's what it represented for us. But, Phillip, the specific track?
Well, it was just the best one that echoed through those woods. And it's not just the Von Trapps, it's our own singers as well.
Right.
It, you know, in a way, it replaced one of the seminal memories of Lois's book that we didn't specifically include in the film, which was the memory of Christmas that Jonas experiences in the book. So our adaptation of that memory was him seeing someone singing in the early sledding memory, and then finally arriving at that place, which also happens in the book. But we didn't have the specific Christmas memory. Just had the sound of someone singing a song that might be sung at Christmas.
The whole front row has questions.
Brent, fantastic job here, as I think all of us who've been seeing all your work coming out in the last year would feel. I'm wondering here, considering how all of these memories are coming to you, all these, I guess you could kind of call them first-time experiences for Jonas seeing all this stuff, What kind of first-time experiences did you have making this movie in particular, or what kind of stories did you hear from you know, some of the veteran actors here that, you know, kind of informed you about even your job, and how'd you get the baby to cry?
Well, let's start with the latter question because that's a little more fun. I think as soon as the baby saw Philip's face, it just started crying. So did I.
He was always with you when he cried, not with me. I was way over there.
The honest truth is, at the start of the film, when I first met this kid, these two kids, James and Alex, twins, they would put the babies in my arms and they would start crying instantly. And so it became, you know, put the baby in my arms if you want to get it to cry, and then get Brenton to put it somewhere and then he can kind of act crying. But over the months, you develop a really strong bond with these kids. And it was in a way, it was hard to see them go, you know? It was hard to let go.
In terms of your first, though, like, first experiences here, how that may mirror your characters?
Oh, first experiences on set. I guess every movie has its uniqueness. You know, that's the wonderful thing about being an actor, is you kind of jump into a new... Every job is kind of a different thing, and every movie is its own wild beast that you have to just kind of roll with, you know? And I guess that's one of the things I learned from, you know, especially Jeff, who I did most of my scenes with, was you just kind of have to roll with it, you know, and do your best, do the best you can, and try and enjoy it along the way. That was one of the things that I really got from it.
Jeff, you have been doing this for so long. I have to imagine, especially when young actors work with you, do they ask you for advice? And do you offer it?
I offer. I don't know. What do you think? What do you think, man? Did I? You know. We just jam. You know. It's like you know. It's a musical expression, but it also works for making movies too. But Brenton plays guitar. We did a lot of jamming, actually. But you know, having fun. My dad, Lloyd Bridges. He, you know, taught me all the basics of acting. I remember when I got a part in Sea Hunt. He would, you know, set me on his bed and say, you know, now make it seem like it's happening for the first time, you know, but listen to me, don't just say your lines when my mouth stops, you know, you gotta, you know, let what I'm saying kind of inform how you say it, all those things. But the main thing I learned from my dad was really just in observing how he worked and the joy that he had in doing what he loved doing. And that joy, I got to work with him twice as an adult in Tucker and a movie called Blown Away. And in both those movies, whenever my dad came on the set, that joyful vibe kind of came with him. And it's contagious. It kind of runs through the, you know, through the whole company, and everybody goes, oh yeah, this is kind of fun. This is kind of, you know, advanced pretend, right? We got all the cool kids, we got the cool thing, it's fun. And you kind of relax when you're feeling joyful, and then all of the, you know, the good stuff gets to come through,
We actually, we had an amazing, I mean, we filmed in South Africa, and it was just, it was a really magical set, and, you know, Cameron, Brenton, they all play guitar, and Taylor came, and Taylor played guitar, and Odeya would sing, and Michael would play piano, Michael was playing piano, so, and, you know, it was, we were in a really interesting part of the world, doing this, doing something really special, so it was a pretty amazing time.
When I told my readers that I was going to give her a press junket, and everybody was like, "Yeah, that's my childhood favorite book," and they're, you know, we know that fans of the books are sometimes can be critical. They have this picture or image in their minds of who should play this favorite character or of theirs. So even you, Jeff, pictured, you know, the great Lloyd in the role. So at the start of the production, I mean, has it always been well received about your choice of cast here, or was there some backlash?
It was tough for me, you know. Wanting to direct it myself, I had a certain vision of how it would go, and I really was in love with the book, and I wanted to, you know, really give a, you know, I wanted to put the book up on screen exactly how it was, and then as I got closer to the movie being, I saw it was actually going to be made, and I had a decision whether I was going to come on board and play the giver, or if I was just going to say, you know, bon voyage, guys, best of luck, you know. But I'm not going to join you. And I thought about that. Often what I do when I come to those crossroads in my life, I try to project myself into the future and think, you know, how am I going to feel if I let this one go or, like, engage, you know? And I felt just terrible letting this thing go. So I decided to do kind of an experiment on myself and just say, just go for it and, you know, dance with the universe. You know, look at all these different... you know, you have got Harvey Weinstein and Walden. Look at the movies that have come out of their oven, you know. And just, you know, I use this word again, but it comes to mind here, jam, you know. Have a jam session with, and look at all the artists that came in. And then kind of give up your idea of control, you know, which in a way is a theme of the movie. You know, just dance with this thing. And I'm so glad I... did that, it made that choice, because it kind of transcended all of my expectations and my ideas. You know, one of the things I was most concerned about was the age of Brenton and Odeya's character, you know. And I struggled with letting that go, but I finally did. And then when these guys showed up, I said, oh, I'm glad I did that. I'm glad I let that go, because they were so, you know, that first shot of Brenton, you know, riding that bike and looking up at those trees, you think, oh, this is, you know, a guy who's, you know, at the cresting of his life. You know, it's just, you know, it was perfect. And Brenton came up with an interesting thing. He said the other day, you were saying, you know, it's a ceremony of 12 in the book. And he said, well, that could be the ceremony of the 12th grade, you know. And he's, you know, young enough to pass for a, you know, a 12th grader, you know. So I think, it worked really well.
Now, I had heard that you actually shot a version of this film with your dad.
That's true.
Is there any way that could be on the DVD?
You know, Beau's son, Casey Bridges, shot was our DP on that particular session in my parents' house. And we read the whole book. Bud Cort was the narrator. This is like 18 years ago. Bud read all the narration in the book, and we have this DVD, or no, it wasn't a DVD, I don't know what it was, a Betamax or something, you know, and we have this in some garage, and Casey, you know, tells me he's got it, and so hopefully that'll be, you know, something on the DVD or something like that. But this movie, this is a one-of-a-kind experience for me. I've never had that kind of... you know, passion or intention for a project, for, you know, and holding it for 18 years. So it's very gratifying to see it finally come to fruition here.
Okay, thank you. As the person who's sat with this the longest, Lois, what was it like for you to finally see it on the big screen?
Confession, I haven't seen it. I've seen a version probably 3 weeks ago, and Phillip tells me that that was not the final version. But in answer to your question, I've been watching this project for many, many years, and for the past year and a half, of course, night and day, and it's been wonderful. I'm accustomed to sitting alone in a room and doing what I do, and controlling everything that I do. I get to write the screenplay and the dialogue, and I design the costumes and the set, and I choose the camera angles when I'm writing a book. So then to relinquish it to a collaborative effort is very different and interesting to watch. Not threatening, because I knew it was in good hands all along. Over the years, I talked to Jeff from time to time, and I could perceive his passion, and that it was in the right hands. So I wasn't nervous about it. Well, sometimes I was a little nervous about it. And then when it was cast, and I knew who the roles would be played by, although I hadn't seen any of the kids yet, I did know the other performers. And I just felt as though it was all going together, everything going into the right slot.
We have time for one more question right here.
My question is for Jeff. It's working with Taylor. What type of the actress she is?
Taylor, God, she was so remarkable. She, you know, flew in, I think her, you know, first day of work was, you know, right on the heels of arriving in Cape Town, and, you know, certainly exhausted, and I had experienced that myself. I would have been exhausted, but she was such a pro and so up for, you know, being involved and playing, and took right to the, you know, I hope she continues the acting, because she's, I think, very talented, as well as being a great songwriter and performer, she was just, you know, wonderful. I think she really adds, and I believe she was Harvey's idea, wasn't she? Harvey Weinstein. Yeah. He said, well, you know, there's a you're being taught a piano here. Who would be somebody really great for that part? And Taylor came to his mind, and I'm so glad she stepped on board. She had read the book, I believe, and was you know a big fan of that. She's, you know, terrific.
Well, I want to thank you guys so much for being here. Congratulations
again.
Thanks
for having me.
Thank you.